Hello, my name is Clay Thompson. In this video, I'm going to tell you how you can use directed acyclic graphs in the causal graph procedure as part of a rigorous causal inference workflow. Let's begin with a simple simulated example. Suppose you have been asked to examine the causal link between chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, or COPD, and exercise capacity, as measured by the maximum rate of oxygen consumption during exercise, or VO2 max. To answer this question, you have a data set that includes an indicator for COPD diagnosis, measured VO2 max, and self-reported physical activity level. Of course, these data could not have been collected as part of a randomized experiment because it does not make sense to consider randomly assigning an individual to have COPD. In this simulated example, one quantity you can compute is the marginal association between COPD and VO2 max. On the other hand, a rule of thumb is that you should always adjust for all available background covariates. In this example, you might consider self-reported activity level to be a background covariate, and so you might stratify your analysis by the levels of this variable. Thus, you have two different analyses that produce two different estimates. How can you decide which estimate best represents the causal effect you are studying? To answer this question, you need to clearly articulate and examine the causal assumptions that inform your analysis. A directed acyclic graph, or DAG, is a simple yet powerful tool that you can use to reason about your causal assumptions. In this example, you are interested in estimating the causal association between COPD and exercise capacity. But it might be the case that activity creates confounding association between the quantities of interest. For example, high activity levels might make it less likely that someone is diagnosed with COPD, and high activity levels might also cause an increase in VO2 max. If this is really the case, then adjustment, in this case via stratification, for activity blocks the confounding association. Under these causal assumptions, the causal effect of interest is estimated by the stratified table. Notice that this discussion is based entirely on the causal assumptions as represented in the DAG. This is important because different causal assumptions lead to different analyses. Here is the causal model that you just analyzed, where activity creates confounding association between the treatment and outcome of interest. However, this is not the only possible causal model. For example, it might make more sense to view activity as a mediating construct rather than as a confounder. That is, individuals with COPD are less likely to be active, which in turn decreases VO2 max. Under these assumptions, it would be a mistake to adjust for activity, because doing so would block the part of the causal effect that is attributable to the mediating pathway. Yet another alternative is that activity does not have any direct causal links to the treatment or outcome variables. Rather, there are unobserved factors, such as genetic or environmental factors, that create confounding association between COPD and activity, and between activity and VO2 max. Under these assumptions, you would again use the marginal rather than adjusted association in order to estimate the causal effect. In this simple example, you can see that your analysis is determined by your causal assumptions as specified in a DAG. How do you specify a DAG for your research question? And how do you use that DAG to determine a proper analysis? That is the purpose of the causal graph procedure. The causal graph procedure analyzes graphical causal models in order to determine an identification strategy for the causal effect that you want to estimate. It is important to emphasize that the causal model, a DAG, is provided as input to PROC CAUSALGRAPH. This DAG should represent your qualitative causal assumptions about the process you want to study. You also must specify the treatment and outcome that you are interested in studying. The CAUSALGRAPH output tells you what statistical adjustments you need to make in order to estimate a causal effect. You can use many different methods to make these adjustments, depending on your preference and experience. For example, you might use covariate matching, inverse probability weighting, or a regression analysis. Let's work through a larger example. Suppose you want to estimate the causal link between cardiac ejection fraction and on-site versus off-site physical therapy following coronary artery bypass graft, or CABG, surgery. To perform this analysis, you have electronic health records from 1,000 patients. These records contain data for several variables that will be useful for the analysis. For the purposes of demonstration, this example uses simulated data so that the average treatment effect for the treated, or ATT, is known to be negative 0.5. The ATT is one particular type of causal estimand that is often useful to consider. For more information about causal estimands, see the references at the end of this presentation. As mentioned previously, a DAG represents qualitative causal relationships. To create a DAG, one useful approach is to begin with the causal mechanism that you want to study. This includes the treatment variable, the outcome variable, and any mediating variables. In this example, there is no mediator, so the causal mechanism consists of a treatment variable and an outcome variable joined together by a direct causal link. Next, recursively add all the common causes for any variables that are already included in the graph. For example, you might assume that age is a common cause of physical therapy location and post-surgery ejection fraction. Moreover, some of the effect of age on physical therapy location might be mediated through the type of surgery. Now that surgery type is included in the DAG, you might assume that pre-surgery ejection fraction is a common cause of both surgery type and physical therapy location. It is important to remember that you should not limit your causal diagram to only those variables that appear in the available data. In this example, the latent construct MedProc represents the propensity of individuals to take medication that is prescribed for them. Also, note that you do not need to include exogenous error terms in the causal diagram. The only exception is for exogenous errors that represent confounding association between two or more factors. You should continue this recursive process until you are satisfied that your causal diagram is complete. This will occur when all the meaningful causal mechanisms and statistical associations are represented in the model. Again, see the references at the end of this presentation for more details. Next, use the CausalGraph procedure to analyze your DAG. PROC CausalGraph contains a very flexible grammar for model specification. You use this grammar to specify all the edges that appear in your diagram. You can use an unmeasured statement to specify those constructs that do not appear in the available data. Finally, you specify the treatment variable and the outcome variable in the identify statement. When you perform an analysis using PROC CausalGraph, the procedure produces a table of adjustment sets that you can use to estimate the causal effect of interest. In this example, there is a single valid adjustment set. This set contains three variables: age, pre-surgery ejection fraction, and surgery type. Finally, you are ready to use this adjustment set to estimate a causal effect. This example uses PROC PS Match to produce an optimal matching. PROC PS Match can produce many different diagnostic plots and tables that you can use to assess the quality of a matching analysis. One of these plots, a standardized mean differences plot, is shown here. You can use the output dataset produced by PROC PS Match with the t-test procedure to estimate the causal effect. Recall that this is a simulated example and the true ATT is known to be negative 0.5, so the analysis shown here accurately reproduces the known true value. In summary, there are many practical applications that require causal analysis of data from non-randomized experiments. Causal graphs are a powerful tool that you can use to handle many of the subtle difficulties that arise from the lack of randomization in these studies. The causal graph procedure is designed to help you use DAGs by providing a convenient combination of grammar and options to articulate model assumptions and assess the identifiability of a causal effect. As you have seen, the results from PROC CausalGraph are easily incorporated into other statistical analysis procedures. In this presentation, you have seen a number of the important features of PROC CausalGraph. In addition to these features, PROC CausalGraph also includes the capability to enumerate paths in a causal model or to enumerate the statistically testable assumptions of a causal model. PROC CausalGraph can also accommodate multiple treatment variables, multiple outcome variables, and even multiple causal models simultaneously. Here is a selection of references where you can find more information about the technical details of the CausalGraph procedure. Thank you for watching.